And then you actually left the Juku system and you were hired as direct hire for the Osaka Board of Education.
Wow, that was cool. That
which was so cool. Which if you understand the life of an ALT, you know that most ALTs are hired either through a local board of education or through a school directly. So in Rob's case, he was hired through the Board of Education.
Yep, because the other alternative is the dispatch company. Right. Yeah.
So can you talk about a little bit? Do you what's the difference between working from the previous job to the direct hire?
Yeah. Okay. Really quick, a little bit about how I did that transition.
Okay. Oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
I was up in Sendai, and I was about ready for a change. I knew I was ready for a change. You know what I mean? I knew I wanted to keep teaching English. I didn't feel quite ready to move to something else. And I had made friends in Kansai. Mm-hmm. So I mean, I have a lot of friends in Kansai, and I put a message on my Facebook, and I was just like, hey, I'm just thinking about a change. So if any of you guys see anything, let me know. One of my really, really great friends, really great person for me, told her mom that, and her mom was like, I got some free time. She called around some boards of education, found out one of them was hiring, sent me the information, was like, you got to be on a plane next week to be in Osaka and take that interview. And I was like, and I'm sitting there like running the calculations. You know, I got like the green accounting cat out. I'm punching numbers, and I'm like, "We're gonna make it work. We're gonna make it work." So, and that's how I got it. Basically, okay. Was a friend told me, "Hey, they're hiring. Go for it. If you know Japanese, you're in a much better position because those job listings are, as counterintuitive as it sounds, 9 were exclusively Japanese. Mm-hmm. They were hiring for an English position, but exclusively. Anyway, it is a world apart.
Okay,
it is completely different. Every situation is different, of course.
Right, or the ESID, the famous JET mantra. But, you know, that's not true just for JET. That's true for everyone.
And everything, really. Yeah,
really. It really is. So, you were, for the Juku, you were teaching after school for the direct hire. What did you do?
I thought, so right, this is really great. I went into work at 8:30 in the morning. I had to be at my desk by 8:30. We taught for the entire standard school day, and I think I left at 4:30. Okay. Just a standard, so I guess the Juku was weird because whenever you're working, you're really working, you're the only one in the classroom, there's like 10 kids going bananas, and you're like, all right, guys, let's wrangle this into some English. It was kind of weird going from that to when I'm in the classroom, I also have a Japanese teacher, you have this situation where when I wasn't in my Juku, I could do whatever I wanted, mm-hmm. but I'd be sitting in the teacher's room like, gotta be productive. So I would read I'd read some kind of like a Japanese novel. So I read Japanese novels because if you were studying, that was okay. Mm-hmm. It was a little bit weird having a really crazy degree of freedom. You have a lot more freedom, not just to design the curriculum, right? In the way we deal with the kids. Mm-hmm. And the Juku, like it or not, most people actually don't go to Juku to learn English. I know that sounds really counterintuitive. They don't. Most people go to Juku to be satisfied. And the difference is, and this is really important because I taught English a little bit like one-on-one with, you know, as a side job. People having a high level of English progression and people being satisfied are not the same thing. People will continue going to your business or your class if it's fun. Right? I mean, granted, if they've been going for 2 years and never learned anything, they're going to leave. But
right. But
the main factor for them is fun. And public schools, I care about your fun. I want to have some great games. The public school system doesn't care about your fun because you got to come back tomorrow, kids.
That's right.
So,
you don't have a choice.
So for the Juku, it would be like, games a little bit over English. And in high school, they're like, in middle school, they were like, we got to cover this material. We got to cover this material.
Yeah.
So that was a really different feeling.
Yeah.
Was that whole like, and of course the discipline hierarchy and everything is completely different, right?
Sure, sure.
So yeah, it was a change up. All right. It was a real change.
So I think a good question at this point for everyone who's watching this video, who wants to work and live in Japan, teach English, what was the pay scale like for Juku and then as the direct hire?
Right, okay, so I'm not, talking numbers doesn't bother me at all, right? So when I went into the Juku, they started doing, and this is going to get, I'm going to try to keep this pretty simple. It was 25 mon a month, which is about, it depends on the exchange rate whenever you're watching this video, safe peg is $2,500 a month. That's pretty safe.
So 25 mon is 250,000 yen. A month.
Oh, right. Of course, if you don't.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Sorry. It's what we do. That's, we count things in mon here.
Yeah.
Yeah. Correct. So it's about 2,500 a month. But there's something that's really, really important. And I can't get into the super specifics because you'll know immediately which one this is if you look it up. They said that they covered certain insurances, but looking into it, they only covered them partially. So to talk about the insurance thing really quick, because this isn't a problem in the ALT world. This is a real problem in the Juku world. If you work under a certain amount of hours per week, they don't pay half of your health insurance.
Mm-hmm.
And in the ALT world, they do, of course. It comes, right. It's right there. Like, the other half comes out of your paycheck and you're good to go, right? They do not do that in the JUCO world for the vast majority of jobs. And if you think you have a full-time job, check, because I guarantee you they're going to pay you on what's called working hours instead of hours in the classroom, which also illegal, that you can press. But yeah. So I was making 25, but I was actually taking home significantly less than that. I'd say realistically my take home was, before rent and everything, was probably about maybe 21. Okay. And then after that, I'm sorry, $22,100. And then after that, that job also did not take out my city tax. Mm. So the next year, I got a bill for $1,000-something. And you get to pay it back over 4 installments over the course of a year. You're not like, oh, I didn't save them, done. But that was an unpleasant surprise. Okay. And then I moved to the BOE. The BOE was $2,750 a month.
Okay.
At that exchange rate, right? Right. 100 yen to a dollar. It was $2,750 a month. And they paid for my city tax as I went, which was no surprise bills. And they also paid for my half my health insurance and stuff like that. Actually, I don't know if this is my case. Maybe it's because I didn't have like the Shakaioken. I didn't have the general health insurance. Yeah. I had some weird health insurance. Like, I had, like, a different, like, my card was completely different. Everything was really weird. So it was pretty expensive. It was, like, $450 a month. It wasn't cheap. Okay. But, yeah, whatever. But my take home was still, even with that, it was much better.
All right. Okay. So, having lived in both Sendai, having lived in Osaka, and doing the teaching job, doing that scene, is there a place that you would recommend people don't move to if they're coming to Japan to teach Eikaiwa?
Yeah, okay. So this is also, I guess, a big thing. And this, I think, this ties into you because you live in Chiba. You live way out in Chiba where you live right now. Way, like, hours from... The thing is, right, you have to move where you're going to be happy. Like, Sendai wasn't bad. It wasn't. It was not bad. Mm-hmm. But Osaka just destroys it.
Right.
Right. And I've got Osaka pride and whatever. But at the end of the day, like, Sendai, and this is, if you look this up, I'm sure I'll be immediately proven wrong, but it feels like Sendai's like the size of one of Osaka's districts, maybe. Like, it's just, there's a huge size difference, and there's also a huge attitude difference. And I think this is, I mean, you have countryside versus city, but you also have to think about the culture of where you're going to live. Like, people in Tokyo City tend to be pretty cold out on the street. With any big city. Mm-hmm. It's not just Tokyo, right?
Right, right.
People in Sendai, they tend to be a little bit, and I don't mean this in a negative way, I don't mean xenophobic, afraid of foreigners. And by that I mean, like, if I was polite and they understood that I spoke Japanese, oh, they'd talk to me all day. I had these old men on the train that would just talk to me, like, for the 40-minute train route to wherever I was going. But they wouldn't approach me. Yeah. And they, you know, they give you the berth. You know what I mean? But when they're approached, they're very friendly people and they're fine. They're just nervous. They don't want you to speak English to them and stuff like that, you know?
Yeah.
In Osaka, no. In Osaka, I'll constantly, drunk people come up to me and they're just like, hey, you, me, let's go for a drink. Or they'll initiate a conversation. Yeah. Or you'll talk to them and they'll just chat and chat and chat because it's fascinating to them. Osaka people are crazy friendly, so.
But, okay. So, I mean, for people friendly-wise, that's really fantastic and great. Yeah. Not something you really need to worry about if you're looking to make friends, but, like, financially speaking.
Right.
Because your salaries were different in both locations.
Yeah, and now I live in Yokohama, which is also a very different cost of living.
Right.
Yeah, honestly, in terms of cost of, rents and whatnot, it's a little difficult for me to say because the Juku chose my Sendai place, and I paid an outrageous amount. The amount that I paid for, two-bedroom dining room kitchen in Osaka... fairly outside the city limits. I was like 20 minutes outside the city limits, though. I paid for a one room in Sendai, but that's because my Juku had contracts with a company called Leo Palace, and it was not a good arrangement. I was the one that got screwed there.
the first company you're gonna see when you come to Japan to live, if you have to get an apartment, the big company is Leo Palace.
If you can avoid Leo Palace,
avoid them. Like, if you can,
I mean, they deal with English, so that's great. Right. But no, avoid Leo Palace, like, because they're insanely expensive.
If for nothing else, Leo Palace, fine. You know, if all else fails, Leo Palace.
Oh, also, really quick. Oh, speaking of Leo Palace, in Sendai, it was really hard for me to get an apartment outside of Leo Palace. I got no foreigners when I would go to... And Osaka, I never had the no foreigners problem. I went in, I was like, they're like, do you have a visa? Yeah, cool. How long? About a year until it gets renewed. And then they're like, okay, do you have a guarantor? No, I'd like to use a guarantor company. No problem. Because maybe it's because I can speak Japanese at that point. I don't. But in Sendai, I could speak into Japanese. And I remember going into two different real estate places with my girlfriend. Yeah. And I was like, hey, you know, between the two of us, we've got, we had a good chunk of change saved, enough for a down payment on any of those places. And I was like, we'd love to move in. And they were like, yeah, no foreigners.
Yeah.
And I was like, my company, what if my company guarantors me? They're like, your company can take the apartment out and let you live there. But no, we just don't deal with foreigners.
No foreigners allowed is not a violation of the law.
Except for the only exception are hotels. Right. It is a criminal offense for somebody to deny you lodging because you are a foreigner, but it's only a civil offense for them to deny you anything else. So if you went to a bar and said, I want to get some food, like, and I have never had this happen to me outside of that real estate incident. I've never had a person say no foreigners, mm-hmm. but it can happen. And if it does, you basically have no recourse.
Right.
Effectively, you have no recourse.
Right, right. And it's just, and honestly, do you want to live in a place that's not, that says no foreigners? Like, do you really want to push the issue?
That's true.
Because all you're going to do is upset the landlord. And if you do end up in that place,
it's going to be a terrible situation.
Yeah. What kind of relationship are you going to have?
Not that that's condoning that at all. Right.
Right. But no. Obviously, no one's condoning, you know, racism. But why deal with it? Especially since they're not going to be held accountable.
Yeah. It's true. It's not a good part of Japan.
And it's not necessarily, you know, out of racism either. We have visas. We're temporary. We're very transitory citizens of Japan, or citizens of Japan. They don't know when we're going to leave.
Yep.
So.
And that's another thing those landlords talked about. And it's a legitimate concern. They have communication concerns, right? Yep. And they also have a problem like, if you damage my apartment and go home, I have nothing. There's no way. It's gone. That's just all money on the drain.
Yeah.
So, and you could say security deposit and things, but it's a fact. So, yeah. Absolutely.
So, don't be discouraged if you come to Japan and they say no foreigners. Just find someplace else. You'll find someplace else.
Like, I have a great apartment right now, and everyone was super cooperative and super helpful. And, I mean, and literally, the only time they were like, hey, he's an American, and the only thing they asked was, can you speak Japanese? He's incredible. Great, come in.
Yeah.
And that was it. I didn't need a Japanese guarantor or anything.
You work at the Juku, and you had plenty of free time, said Japanese, and you switched to the direct hire at the Board of Education. And I know you also had plenty of free time.
Yeah, I had some hours.
So the really interesting thing is that, you know, when you come to Japan, you're going to be pretty much pigeonholed into one category. There's two categories. Either you're teaching English or you're working at some random company.
Yeah.
So, but Rob has kind of moved on, you know, and kind of like broken away from that system. So, because he had so much free time, let Rob explain it. So, what did you do explicitly during that free time?
Right.
That ties into what you're doing now.
Right. So, when I was in Sendai, I started studying to make video games, actually. Not even studying. I was just like, man, I want to make games. So, I just started learning about how to make games, and I would read, like, programming books, the fundamentals of programming, on my 40-minute train rides to these classes out in the middle of nowhere. And then after that, I would boot up this game engine called Unity, and I'd start cracking around and making all these cool games and stuff. And I thought, you know, this would be really cool to do for a job. So I studied that for about a year. To be fair, though, it wasn't a concentrated year because I was really concerned about getting my N1.
Okay.
So this was back burner. This was absolutely back burner.
Okay.
The
hobbyist.
Yes. It's really what it was. And then after that, I moved to Osaka. During that time, I finished up like my first game, and I started studying a little bit of web dev. And then once I passed the N1, I was like, all right, let's really do this programming thing. Let's try this. And I didn't have to pass the N1. In retrospect, if you're about N2 level, you can work at a Japanese company. You'll be all right. Mm-hmm. And you also don't even need the N2 to do it. They'll see your resume is English and know where you're at. So, your resume is Japanese. It'd be weird if they saw your English. Anyway, but yeah, I started studying web dev. Actually, I was like, man, maybe programming's just not going to work out. Maybe I just can't get a job at a gaming company. I hadn't applied, so I have no idea why I thought that. And then I started studying web dev. And I remember, I published a game on the Google App Store. And then I started studying web dev. And I've been doing that for about 2 months. And I was like, you know what? I'm just going to apply to, like, I seriously did this. I'm going to apply to one game company. Just one. Just, just get the kind of feel for it. And I applied to a game company. It turned out to be a recruiter posing as a game company. But that recruiter was actually a really cool guy. Like, I've eaten, like, kushikatsu. I've eaten, like fried skewered foods with him. Like, shish kebabs, kind of. Not really, but we've gone out and eaten, gone out to drink and stuff. But he was a super cool guy. And he was like, hey, I see you applied to, like, this one game company. I think this would be a better fit for you. And I was like, wait, what? And he was like, yeah, I'm going to send your materials along. And I didn't expect anything. But I was like, okay, cool. Calls me a day later, and he's like, hey, they want an interview. And I was like, okay. I had never interviewed at a Japanese, like, game company, right? And I went in for the interview, and we sat there, we had casual conversations. I knew my stuff, as much as a hobbyist programmer can know his stuff.
Right.
But we sat there, we had some casual conversations, and then they were like, hey, the CEO's going to be here in 2 days. We want you to meet with the CEO, which is common practice in Japanese countries. This company's CEO has final say. Met with the CEO a couple days later. He was like, do you have any questions for me? I asked him a bunch of questions about his personal life. And then he thought it was hilarious and hired me. And that's how I started working in game dev, actually. I worked at a really big, in the game industry in Japan. It is a very, very well-known company. But it's not like Capcom or Nintendo. You wouldn't know it from the West. But I started working in a game company right out at the Grand Front. It was a big building in Osaka Station.
All
right. Which was super cool. Also, funny story, the first day I showed up, I remember I had a summer to study for that job, and I was like, is there anything I should study? And they said, no, you're fine. And I remember getting in there the very first day, I remember my mentor, right, goes, so, you know C++? I was like, I've never written C++ in my life. And he goes, everyone on the team knows C++, and you have to know to do your job. So I had to learn it, like, in the space of, like, learning. I didn't know how to use it in the space of, like, 4 days. So that was cool. It was a lot of fun though. They were cool people.
All right. So I'm gonna break his flow and cut him off. So because it's really important, I'm cutting him off for a really good reason. So he was teaching English. I teach English. So when you come to teach English, you come either there's a couple different visa types for English. Mine happens to be an instructor visa, but you can't have an instructor visa and work in a. And working in the game company.
Or in a juku. That's a different visa, too. Yeah, a
different visa, right.
Yep.
So if you come to teach juku or Ikawa, if you're not a direct hire or you know, if you're not a JET participant or Interact participant, then, I don't know so much about Interact. I'm assuming because they do the same job. So he needed a new visa, so.
Yeah, that's actually, that the visa thing's rough. I came on a specialist visa. It was 3 years. I wanted to get changed to an instructor visa. That instructor visa, by the way, only took 4 days to change because my BOE called the government and said that they wanted to get it done. Mm-hmm. It was awesome. But when they changed it to an instructor visa, they changed to a year. Then I got it renewed. It was still only a year. And then I had to get it changed back to a specialist in humanities because a specialist in humanities is actually three. It's specialist humanities, engineer, and something else. I don't know what the third one is. I can't remember. So they had to change it back to that so I could go work in engineering. Yeah.
Okay.
So that's I have, and then from that game job, I'm now working a different job, and I work in web dev. But yeah, all right. that was my visa situation, and that usually to get that visa changed that second time from instructor to specialist took a month and a half.
Okay.
Just the paperwork. It just you fill out all the paperwork, you get some stuff, you have to get a bunch of stamps and all these approvals and stuff, and then you just wait.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So, getting your visa changed, it's not such a big deal. Previously, you'd have to, you know, oh my God. Oh, I remember we did our study abroad. And at that time, we had, now there's the current registration system for foreigners is we have like a foreigner card. Right, the Zayadu Kaldo.
Zayadu Kaldo.
But previously, before that was it the Gaikokujin Torokusho Meisho?
Yep.
And if you wanted to go visit a different country, you had to go to the immigration office, get a stamp in your passport that would allow you to return to Japan.
Multiple entry permit.
Oh my God! Yeah, under the same current visa.
And if you forgot, you were done.
You were done. And yeah. I got a story about that, but it's for a different time. So you know, and a lot of times, you know, if you want to change visa or renew a visa, you would still have to leave the country, which would mean giving up your old, you know, foreigner card and then coming back in to get your new visa. Oh, it's complicated. But now you can change visas in country.
I don't need a multiple entry permit anymore. Right. If I'm not out of the country, I can stay out of the country for up to 3 months and I'm
right. All right. Cool. So good. The visa situation's not, you do need a different visa, but It's possible. It's, you know, pretty easy. As long as the company's willing to sponsor you.
Yeah. Which also, another thing, it's not that difficult. Like, I, in Osaka, I had some problems when I tried to change out of a game dev company. Other game dev companies would hire me, but Osaka's got kind of a conservative mentality when it comes to their markets, mm-hmm. and I just couldn't get work as a non, as a systems engineer right. or whatever. But in Tokyo, no, there was no shortage of companies that were like, well, it's just paperwork. Sure. We do paperwork all the time. Like, I've had companies that didn't have any other foreigners at all that were like, yeah, you can come work here. We'll just get it stamped out. We're good to go. Because they're like, he's got the Japanese. It's not a problem. All
right.
Yeah.
All right. All right.
So don't feel discouraged if you want to change out of it, because the opportunities are absolutely there.
Okay. Okay. Let's change, you know, get away from the visa situation. Sure. So you really want to work in games. Like, and I remember, you know, you trying to learn the games.
Yep.
You know, I remember, you know, helping to do the demo testing on the game that you made.
Yeah.
You somehow cheating and always kicking my ass at the game. But no, so you worked in games for what? How long
did you... I worked in an actual game company for almost exactly 1 year. Okay. Like 3 days off of a year.
So, but now, right now, this interview, we're currently in Yokohama. Your new job is here in Yokohama.
Yeah.
But you're not doing games anymore.
Nope.
So, as someone who really wanted to do game development, game design, and all that stuff that you were studying for, why did you choose to switch your profession again? Yeah. You're still doing, like, you know,
coding and programming. Right. You can
do a lot. But why the change?
Yeah, okay, that's a good question. And I guess I don't really want to, like, because if I talk too long about this, it's just going to devolve into a bashing on the Japanese game industry. But to put it simply, the reason why I changed, there were two really big ones. The first one, which is a little bit of a more minor one, and I think it's important to touch on maybe a little bit later, mm-hmm. is the hierarchy of my organization. Every core person is going to feel bureaucratic to an extent. Mine felt needlessly bureaucratic. And this isn't even an exaggeration, we would have 45-minute stand-up impromptu meetings about decisions that should have taken 5 minutes. Mm. Like, it got to the point where I was like, I don't feel like I'm actually working anymore. I'd have entire weeks where I just didn't work at all. Because we just, meeting after meeting, like, no exaggeration, literally days of meetings, I couldn't handle it. And the other one is I lost faith in what I was doing. I actually still love game dev. Like, after I left that company, I continued to privately develop games with a good friend, an animator friend I'd made from that company. Mm-hmm. It's a really fun game. I still love it. I love game dev. It's so rewarding. But the problem is, in that company, I had been working on a game. It was a smartphone MMO, and I did both server and client side. Everyone did everything. But the thing was, it was just a cash grab game. It was ostensibly an RPG to look at. But realistically, it was, you're going to grind a bunch, and if you want to circumvent the grind, you can drop a bunch of money to play what are basically like these, they're called gachas in Japanese, but they're like these random little lottery things. Like, you know when you go to when you're a kid, you go to the store, and they have those like plastic ball things, yeah. and you get a prize, exactly like that.
Ah.
And it was that, you know, that sort of predatory model where it's like, okay, 1% of our players are paying thousands of dollars a month to keep the game afloat and all that stuff, and it just disillusioned me. Like, they call them social games in Japan, where you're supposed to play with your friends and you play on your phone and you basically play these lotteries together, and I didn't believe in anything we were doing anymore. I just didn't believe in anything I was doing anymore, and I decided it was time for a change. Because I think when you don't enjoy going to work, it's time to think about...
Yeah.
That's why I left English teaching.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Fair enough. Okay, so what do you currently do now then?
Right, so now I've said I'm both because I am both. My official title is systems engineer, which sounds really cool. But actually, I do back-end server web dev. So what that means is, if you have a website that needs building and you're like, okay, we're going to have a campaign to decide who thinks, which hairstyle of Jesse's do we like the more, hairstyle A or B, and you do a voting system. I'm the guy who will go, okay, I'm going to set up the servers and the infrastructure and the throughput. So when this goes viral and 50,000 people on Twitter decide that I want to vote at once, your website doesn't explode. Okay. That's what I do. I do systems architecture and deployment.
Did you have any expectations about Japan before coming to work? Because you did the study abroad.
Yeah.
But what about your expectations of working here?
All right, so that was a big thing, right? Because I knew studying abroad was just all kind of fun in games and just having a good time. Because it was. I mean, studying abroad was easier than what I was studying back in the States, right? I was studying science. I just came here and studied Japanese. It was fun. And I realized working for a Japanese company is going to be different because you always hear about, like, Japan's, like, so-called black companies where they're, like they have black business practices. They're very dark and malicious.
Can you explain that
really? Yeah, yeah, because it sounds racist. It sounds terribly racist. A black company, the idea is black in the sense of having, like no morals. Like black business practices or dark business practices. And it would be the kind of thing where, and this is no exaggeration, actually my girlfriend works in HR and she was telling me a story about this. She does consultations with like CEOs, company presidents, and one of the company presidents, she had called him like to the office for a face-to-face meeting because his average overtime worked hours for each week for his employees was 48 per week. They had worked something like over 180 something hours of overtime in 1 month. And we're sitting there doing the math, right? And I'm like, what? And she's like, yeah, it comes out to like, it was like 8.5 or 9 hours a day if you also work Saturday and Sunday full time. And I mean, the next month he ended up giving them all the entire month off because they had to meet some project or whatever. But that's what I had expected coming in, right? I'm like, man, when I go in, I'm going to have to be ready to do 2 hours of unpaid overtime every day because they have this thing, it's basically called service overtime. Which is you're legally paid for these 2 hours, but you're not actually because it's included in your contract. Mm-hmm. And it's very complicated to explain. Basically, all your overtime is unpaid.
Basically, it's if it's like if you're salaried in, you know, back home in the United States, if you're in a salary and you're not per hour, you just don't. It's the kind of same
idea. Yeah, exactly. So I was ready for that. I think I have worked a grand total of maybe 10 hours of overtime in my life here.
Okay.
Because I was coding something, I made a mistake, it was my fault, and I had to work till basically last train because, like, literally hundreds of thousands of dollars went on the line for something I made a mistake on. The other times were just because I was actually really interested in what I was doing and decided I wanted to stay late. But no, every time, like, clock out's at 7 o'clock on the dot, all right, guys, take it easy. I mean, all my Japanese coworkers stayed late.
Sure.
But I went home early, so.
That's their culture.
But I was expecting blacker, darker business practices, and it was fine.
Okay.
It actually turned out really well.
All right. So was there anything where that maybe, so you were expecting like the black corporations and the companies and the crazy overtime. Is there anything that you thought otherwise that was like spot on?
Yeah, I expected, and this is going to sound super negative. I expected from a juku or my ekai at some point to try to screw me over, and they did. Legally speaking, I mean, like, they, so, yeah, I was absolutely expecting a situation where if I didn't push for my rights, they just weren't going to get enforced.
Okay.
And that is the typical, and if you push, you're fine.
Right.
But that is what I'd say is a very typical representation of the Ekai experience
here. Okay.